Now, remember I began with a quotation from John Dewey. Y'all remember that quotation? Okay, somebody shook their head. It is proper to say, I'm glad you shook your head. See, y'all like, yeah, no, you don't remember that. It is proper to say that in choosing this object rather than that, one is in reality choosing what kind of person or self one is going to be. Right? Remember that. That's the end of that quotation. The sentence that I just read, right? I want to critically examine a particular view of black identity, which assumes that notions of obligation to the race and the desires and purposes of African-American individuals are derivative and dependent on a view of who we take ourselves to be, independent of the choices we make. I do this with an eye fixed intensely on the task of reconstructing the way many African-Americans think of their ethical lives in relation to their political choices. The choices we make have everything to do with who we take ourselves to be. Not just simply who we take ourselves to be dictating our choices. I'm flipping it in a way. Does that make sense? And this is the kind of pragmatic move that I want to explore. Now, I maintain that notions of virtue, I don't know why I did that, right, and good flow, as John Dewey says, from independent springs, such that each has an equally legitimate basis and can pull us in different and sometimes conflicting directions. This makes moral decision a real problem and gives ethical judgment and moral discernment their vitality. It's not just simply a matter of knowing what's right and wrong, the difference between right and wrong. That's pretty straightforward, right? It's oftentimes, that's not really a kind of dilemma. You just have to convince yourself to do wrong because you already know what wrong is. Really, the kind of moral dilemma rests when you have a conflict of goods, right? That is to say, I desire this as good, but I have this as my duty, right? Sartre's No Exit, right? And Pierre, do I stay home and take care of my sick mother, or do I go and fight in the resistance, right? The moral life is much more complex than just simply right and wrong, right? It's the fact that the good, the right, the virtuous collide. My claim points to the tragic dimensions of the world of action, that we often find ourselves confronted with competing goods as we act. It also locates the notion of character development and moral progress in our ability to make delicate distinctions in the face of the precariousness of a world in which doubt and the need for choice impinge at every turn. Our moral decisions are not settled by reference to some fixed and unchanging racial identity. That would deny the implications of the contingency of our moral lives. Instead, it turns out, and that was a very controversial claim, by the way, that we can talk about. Instead, it turns out that our individual and collective identities are in part a consequence of our moral decisions. My concern here is not whether races are real or not, or whether races are objectively true or false. Reality for me is a denotative term. It designates everything that happens. Lies, for me, are as real as trees, right? If you don't believe me, just give me your money. Give me your $5 bill. If you don't think a $5 bill is real, give it to me. It's just paper with ink on it, right? But that's a different kind of art. Arguments that claim that races are not real because they are predicated on false notions are arguments that conclude that black identities are incoherent because they are based on such false notions. Those sorts of arguments do not move me very much. I'm more concerned with social practices, within which race talk matters deeply. But even if you disagree with my naive realism, I invoked that phrase to the president this morning, today, one can certainly talk about utterances that involve race language without talking about, without taking as our major concern the truth or falsity of the utterances. Our concern, for example, may involve the appropriateness or correctness of language, of such language use. And an utterance can be true and inappropriate, right? For my purposes, then, the issue of whether races are real or not is beside the point, because my principal concern lies with the practices that constitute the use of a shared language. I'm not suggesting here that the objective status of races isn't an interesting question, simply that it is not the only question when we take up matters of race. I'm also not interested in defending what many folk call an essentialist conception of race or black identity. Talk of racial essences are at best bad ways of talking about particular experiences, or at worst, misguided quests for certainty that aim to secure us from the contingency that is an inherent part of our lives. My hope is to offer a pragmatic way of thinking about black identity, which evades these narrow options and takes seriously the problem-solving activity that is an intrinsic part of what it means to be a moral agent. The emphasis then is on our capacity as black individuals to judge the respective claims of duty and desire as they arise in concrete experience, understanding that in some cases they may indeed conflict. Black identity talk remains. We simply should not overextend its reach. Let me translate for a moment. Part of what I'm up to in this particular talk is to kind of resist the notion that to embrace black identity is to define the sorts of choices that I make. That African-American moral lives, right, are rendered intelligible in some significant way by the fact of their blackness, right? And part of what I want to do is to kind of expose the complexity of what it means to embrace the notion of black identity, of embracing a black identity in the context of a world that's organized along racist assumptions, right? To give attention to that complexity without reducing it to some essentialized notion. Right? What does it mean to just simply say black folk are complex people too, right? And how can we think about this in a way without giving short riff to the historical significance of what it means to embrace a notion of blackness? So for example, when someone utters a sentence like this, I'm an African American, in the context of a debate about public policy, on my view, she's not disclosing for all to see something that was previously internal. Instead, her words orient those around her, for better or worse, in a particular kind of way. They understand that for her, when it comes to this particular topic, another set of issues must be taken into account. The late Richard Rorty makes the point best, in my view. He writes, such sentences are not used to report events going on within the Cartesian theater, which is a person's consciousness. They are simply tools for coordinating our behavior with those of others. This is not to say that one can reduce mental states such as beliefs and desires to physiological or behavioral states. It is merely to say that there is no point in asking whether a belief represents reality, either mental reality or physical reality, accurately. That is, for the pragmatist, not only a bad question, but the root of much wasted philosophical energy. The question, then, is not whether our beliefs about race and racial identities represent reality, but for what purposes would it be useful to hold such beliefs and to invoke them as crucial aspects of who we take ourselves to be? Now, there are two ways, at least in this talk, of understanding black identity. One I want to call an archaeological approach, and the other is a kind of pragmatic historicist approach. Both, I think, focus on the ethical dimensions of black identity. Obviously, I want to put forward the view that the pragmatist approach best enables us to understand the complex ethical choices that attend any talk of black identity. In the end, I want to suggest that we have approached the issue of black identity from the wrong direction. It's not simply a question of who we are and the answer determines how we act in the world. Rather, the choices we make in the face of problems and meddlesome circumstances turn out to be our lives, requiring of us the continued cultivation of our ability to make delicate distinctions.